Get Ready to Rock, Almost Famous is here. It's Cameron Crowe's autobiographical road trip musical based on his iconic film from 2000. And here's Paul Wontorek with the story.
Thanks, Tamsin. Cameron Crowe is a master at creating iconic moments on the big screen. Now Almost Famous has arrived on stage. I welcomed him to Broadway at the iconic Theater District haunt, Sardi's. We're at Sardi's because you're a Broadway name now. How does that feel?
Wild. When you say it, it feels pretty good. It's a great world to be a part of, for sure. I mean, I love our cast. I'm there every day. They can't get rid of me.
For so many years, I have asked actors, which movie do you want to see become a musical? And I have heard Almost Famous, and I've heard many actresses say that they want to play Penny Lane. I mean, that was part of it. Were you aware of this? Were you aware that there was such a desire to see Almost Famous on Broadway?
Not really. I mean, people asked from time to time over the years, but it's really like the movie kept clicking upwards in terms of people seeing it again or remembering it. And over time, that's mostly all I hear about from stuff that I've done. And people take it so personally, and they're always music lovers. Mm-hmm. So I guess it's natural that we can create an atmosphere that's filled with music where you kind of like feel the elixir when you walk in, and the musical can make you feel the way the movie hopefully made you feel.
Sun has just begun to shine my way. I can feel it. Oh, I can feel it.
I can feel it.
What's cool about this show is that there are a few very well-placed, recognizable rock songs.
Yeah.
But this is an original score. It honors the period while being completely original, while also being theatrical and properly telling the story. I feel like you had to be nervous about getting the music element right. And not, absolutely. You didn't want to make it a jukebox musical. You didn't want to make it a pure greatest hits of the era.
No, I love Jersey Boys. I love Jersey Boys. It was great and really well-written. But for some reason, Almost Famous felt like there was a challenge to kind of look forward and look back. So it wasn't such a kind of nostalgia explosion. That it's kind of like some people that loved music are gonna come together and craft a world where maybe you didn't know that was an Elton John song or not. Oh, I recognized Tiny Dancer. I recognized Cat Stevens' song, but like that's a song that, wait a minute, did I? And I love that game, and Tom Kitt was born.
Yeah.
To make that happen. He has such heart and enthusiasm, and he came in and was just so openly loving of Almost Famous, and he said, I really want this job, it's my dream. And I'm like, your dream is realized, let's go. And we've had such a great experience writing lyrics, but also just kind of channeling the feeling of the day. That little time before everything got super mainstreamed. To see Elton John or Joni Mitchell or Cat Stevens, you'd go to a place like our theater where we have the musical now. So it felt authentic that we would create that world. And that music 50 years later is still relevant.
I can't wait for the cast album because I love this score so much. And I have a friend named Larry who considers himself a music expert of the era. And I told him to go see the show, and he very warily went into it and was like, This is correct. So
you did okay with Larry?
If Larry gave Almost Famous 2 thumbs up, so I don't know, I think you're done.
Walk away, we're good. We're good, we have Larry. Come on.
Joni Mitchell came to your opening actually out in California. Did you get the thumbs up from Joni?
Paul, I was terrified. I've loved writing about her for a long time. I kind of like, when I was at Rolling Stone, that was my domain. I was like, I'm gonna plant a flag and write about Joni Mitchell as much as you let me. And she let us have a river. She let us have a river for the movie of Almost Famous, but then for the musical, she let us have it too. And then we got word that she was coming.
She doesn't make that many appearances.
No, and she was still recovering from an aneurysm that was pretty tough for her. But there she was. The SUV door opens and here's Joni Mitchell coming to your musical, and it's just like, it's giddy and it's terrifying. I've seen her in situations where people covered her music in front of her, and if it doesn't quite hit the note for her, she won't tell you that it did.
Mm-hmm.
She'll be very pleasant and noble and wonderful, but you'll be waiting for something extra. It may not come. So when she saw Almost Famous, the first thing she said is, it's better than the movie. And she's been talking about it ever since, Paul, which is wild. I've done some work with her archival releases, and she can't wait to come see it here. So it's, again, slightly terrifying, but she's seen it, like Larry. So if we scaled the wall with those two, walk away, right?
Let's talk about the story and why people love it so much. What do you think people latch onto about sort of this thing you created all those years ago and won an Oscar for, by the way, for the screenplay? But what do you think has made it so endearing and enduring?
I'm honored by your question. It's truly great, and I'm lucky to even be asked that question. I've thought about it recently, and I think it's because the characters are based on real people. So sometimes when I watch the show, I get lost in it. I get lost in the real people, and I remember them very vividly. And Anika Larsson is my mom. Anika channels the teacher in my mom. Because my mom, you know, as teachers can be, they're always teaching. And that was my mom. Don't take drugs. You can't take drugs. Your brain cells are so valuable. Don't ruin them. You know, and so when she'd get a hold of a rock star on the telephone, for example, yeah, she'd be teaching. That's Anika, and she cracks me up and makes me cry some nights and stuff, most nights. Casey is me on my best day. You know, kind of funny and effervescent, and I love what Casey does. But even the band members and Penny Lane, they scratch at something truly real for me, and I think hopefully that translates to people. They don't feel like concoctions.
I love to imagine that you have this show on Broadway, and you can sit there in the theater and have this intensely personal experience every night with these actors you love. It's just, it's kind of beautiful. I hope to look across the orchestra and see you sitting there having your moments.
Sometimes people sitting in front of me will turn around when it's over and I'll be like this, and they'll be like, are you okay? Oh wait, that's the guy. You signed this playbill? I'm like, yeah. It's okay, it doesn't have to make you cry. They're like, but you crying makes me cry. So it gets messy, you know, in the best way.
You have made a lot of beautiful, very memorable films that have sort of been a big part of my life over the years. But this one is definitely special with people. What is sort of the lesson that you would pass on to filmmakers or artists in general about, is it sort of this? Like, this is obviously very intensely personal to you. Is it sort of like really lean into that?
In a way, Almost Famous should have been the first thing that I did, but it was still kind of bubbling up into being what it was going to be. I wanted to write it as a vehicle for David Bowie. I loved the idea of him playing a kind of down on his luck publicist in the same era. But there was something about the screenplay that was just kind of lopsided, and the woman that passed through the client that was in the story's life was Penny Lane, and I, the reporter, was just a little guy that appeared a little bit. But over time, Paul, it's like the reporter and his family became the story, and music was the context, loving music. So it's family and loving music, and that became Almost Famous. But the good fortune is that because Jerry Maguire happened right before it, I was able to get all the right people to be behind the camera. We had a great cinematographer, and we were able to shoot in the actual places where things happened. Yeah. That was how it became the first movie that came later. I always say, don't write the movie that you think is good in the marketplace that will allow you to do what you really want to do later. You won't get to what you want to do later because you're not being real to begin with. So if you can tell your most personal, embarrassing story first, it just might be the thing that people really hold to their hearts. And then you can do all your other stuff.
Sure.
But that is probably that and Say Anything are the most satisfying things that I've written because they're the most personal.